Thank you, everybody, for coming. I just want to welcome you all for coming today. I really appreciate the opportunity and appreciate you coming. I'm David Vandeveer, the Executive Director of the Psaros Center on Financial Markets and Policy, and we have co-hosted this event with the Georgetown Americas Institute. I want to thank Alejandro, Denise, and Kate for putting it on from the Georgetown Americas Institute. I want to thank Anna and Ethan from the Psaros Center. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Alejandro to kick us off. Thank you.
Thanks the Psaros Center for working with us to organize this event, and mainly thank Nathan Sheets for being here with us. Nathan has a very long career in international finance. He has a PhD from MIT. Then he went to the Federal Reserve Board, where he worked on international financial issues for 18 years, reaching the position of Director of International Finance. That is the highest position at the Federal Reserve system in terms of international markets. And he led the efforts by the Fed, basically, to stabilize the world economy after the global financial crisis, so trying to avoid a significant contagion to those countries that were not suffering from a financial crisis, and trying to solve the international aspects of the global financial crisis. Then he moved to the Treasury, where he also was in charge of the highest position responsible for international financial affairs, the Undersecretariat of International Affairs, I guess, in the Barack Obama administration. And then I guess he didn't have anything else to do on international finance in the public sector, so he moved to the private sector, where he has been the chief economist for Citigroup for the last 4 years, 3 years?
A couple of years,
and before that for other financial institutions. So without further ado, Nathan is going to talk to us about his global economic outlook, and I think this is an extremely challenging year, and hopefully he will give us important hints to try to understand what's going on in the global economy. So with that, Nathan, please, I'll take a seat. He will talk for a while, and then we will open up to Q&A.
All right, well, very good. It's wonderful to be here, and I would like to use the slides. Well, it's wonderful to be here, and especially appreciate the invitation from Alejandro. He and I were classmates in grad school, and consistent with that, throw at me the best questions you have, and the ones that are really hard, I'll pass on to Alejandro, who was a much better student in grad school than I was. Well, it is indeed a challenging global outlook. Now, that said, when I kind of looked at the global economy at the end of last year, I was kind of thinking about where we would be in 2023, I got pretty depressed. And I looked around the world, I saw a lot of problems, a lot of challenges, a lot of difficulties. Very weak growth, probably still high inflation, and central banks hiking. And let's go to the first slide here. The good news is that over the last 6 weeks or so, kind of since I wrote the document saying, oh, 2023 is going to be a grim year, here's some tissues for the tears. Most of the information that we've received over the last six-week period has been more favorable. And specifically, it's been better than we thought in the euro area, and I'll go into details on all of this. It's been better in China, and the data in the United States have been surprisingly resilient. Now, to be clear, we're not prepared to say it's going to be a good year in 2023, but I'm willing to say it's going to be a less bad year. Or if you want to talk about where we land, it's going to be a less hard landing than what we had thought 6 weeks ago. But the basic story, and this kind of summarizes everything that I'll talk about, is these favorable developments have kind of moved the dial from really bad to just challenging. Now, underneath this, and this is something I will come back to again and again in talking about where we are in the global economy. One of the key developments right now is that we are seeing a substitution in consumer spending away from goods and towards services. This is true in the United States, it's true globally as well. And specifically, if you think back, early in the pandemic, people got really nervous about services. And they pulled back, you know, worried about the face-to-face contact, or were locked down and couldn't get out and do these things. So services spending collapsed. But we also realized that, well, the consumption and production of goods is more consistent with our public health considerations. And at that time, people used a lot of e-commerce, bought a lot of technology kinds of products, cell phones, IT, and so forth. People bought a lot of furniture. Over that period, I remember a lot of people, instead of going on vacations, bought furniture and other things for their homes. The housing market boomed and so forth. So early in the pandemic, goods were really strong. But what's happened over the last year and continues to happen is that people are now feeling more comfortable with services. They bought a lot of IT and cell phones and so forth. They're substituting back into services. And that has really important, this strength of services has important implications for the growth outlook, so for real GDP, for inflation, and for labor markets. And I'll come back to that again and again, but that's really a critical development. Now, as a result of the demand for services, tight labor market, and more broadly where the global economy is at the moment, inflation continues to run hot. Central banks look at the high level of inflation as an existential challenge. And as Alejandro said, as somebody who's worked inside a central bank for many years, I think there's a recognition by central bankers that if they can't control inflation, they're really not good for anything. And as they've seen the inflation surge, it's kind of been a four-alarm fire within the central banking community, and they're hiking vigorously to try to bring it down. And we're seeing some progress there, but there's still work to do. So central banks responding vigorously. And given this sequence of events, we see a lot of recession risk in the global economy this year. But an important point is it doesn't look like all of the major economies are going to go down together, right? That there's a story in the United States, there's a story in the euro area, there's a story in China, there's a story in the emerging markets, and they're all pretty different. And so what we have instead is a more synchronized, desynchronized global cycle. And what we've called that is rolling country-level recessions. And you kind of see it here in this chart, where first half of the year, the euro area is really weak. And then in the second half, as the Fed's hiking starts to hit the economy, the United States has a recession, and some of the other countries in North America. And again, with the emerging markets still on other kind of stories. And then actually no recession in China as the Chinese economy accelerates. So this is just a little bit of an overview. Let's go ahead to the next slide. And let me say, feel free to jump in at any point with questions. I'm happy to take them now or later or whatever works for you. All right. So some of the bright points we've seen, China is reopening its economy from COVID. That reopening is happening more vigorously and more extensively than what we'd expected. We kind of thought something would happen in Q1, but this is a much, much bigger deal. Second key point is there have been significant public health consequences associated with the reopening. There was a surge of infections. There's a bit of debate here, but kind of our sense, when I talk to the China analysts at Citi, our sense is we've seen the worst in terms of the public health infections. And in any event, it looks like the authorities are fully committed to hunkering down and kind of getting on to the other side of that wave of COVID cases and reopening the economy. Now, another concern I had was, well, think of yourself, you know, you were, a Chinese citizen hearing for the last 3 years that, COVID's terrible. If you get it, it's gonna be a terrible experience being locked down. And then all of a sudden the government says, never mind. You know, go out and move on your way. You know, that is a very different message, and I was worried about how the Chinese consumers were going to respond. Kind of, where is their heads in this thing? Are they willing to go out and start spending again and traveling and going to restaurants? And so far, the early returns, and this is based on the Chinese New Year last week, the early returns are that they did go out and spend a fair amount of money. You see it in terms of traffic congestion. I have something up here about box office sales, which seem like they're pretty good. They, notwithstanding some of the challenges with infections, they exceeded where they were last year. We're actually above 2019 levels. So it feels like the Chinese consumer is also willing and able to spend. Putting all this together, we expect very strong growth in China this year. Of around five and three quarters, I think the precise number there, it looks like it's 5.7% for the Chinese economy. And I think that is important to keep in mind, that as the Euroware in the United States are seeing growth slow this year, the growth in China is actually accelerating because of its reopening. Any questions on China? Happy to take them if there are any. Okay, let's go on to the Euro area. So another upside surprise, right? For months and months, we were making an argument that the euro area economy was quite likely to see a severe recession during the first part of 2023. What was the basis of our expectation was they just didn't have enough gas to make it through the winter. And given the challenges that they face on the gas front, because Russia stopped shipping them gas, that there would be periods of outright disruptions in gasoline supply. And that would have a big impact on production of goods, and also would be disruptive to families and households that didn't have access to needed power. In the event, the Euro area so far has had a warm, windy winter, and that's been exceptionally good news for them. Why important? Well, the warmth means that they've used less gas. They haven't needed the heating as much as if it'd been cold. And the windy means the wind's still blowing, and they can rely on the wind turbines for renewable sources of energy. As a result of that, as you see here, the gas storage, which is kind of the orangish line there, the gas storage is relatively high. And the probability of an outright disruption in gas supplies this year is much lower. Now, are they entirely out of the woods? It could get cold again. And certainly over the medium to long run, there's still a lot of challenges with energy transition. But for this winter, it's looking much less severe. And instead of numbers for GDP growth like -2 during the first half, now it's looking like, you know, pretty close to zero. So instead of a sharp contraction, the euro area is scoring a stagnation. Still problems. Gas prices are high. It's a challenging environment, but not as bad as what we had feared. As a result of this, kind of as I've suggested, we now expect that the recession, if they have one, will be more short-lived and won't be severe. Now, being an economist, whenever you give me good news, I try to say, you know, yeah, what's the bad news? What's the bad news underneath it? And this is generally good news, that the downturn in Europe's not going to be as severe. The bad news is Europe still has an inflation problem. You see that on the lower right, where the ECB, anybody know what the ECB's inflation target is, the number? Somebody's got to know it. Yes. What did you say? 2%. Exactly. Good guess. So their inflation target is 2%. And right now, headline inflation is running, you know, there's a big drop, and some of that's artificial. But let's call it 8% on headline and 5.5% on core. So inflation is running well above the target. You can make some stories about, you know, supply shocks. They shouldn't be too worried. But any way you cut it, inflation in Europe is well above the ECB's target. Now, the ECB was expecting that the recession, which they also had written in, that the recession was going to open up slack in the economy and help contribute to disinflation. Now there's going to be less of that, but they still have got to bring inflation down. So what does that mean for ECB's policy? Well, it means the ECB is going to have to be tighter, most likely, than they would have been otherwise. And consistent with that, we have the ECB taking its deposit rate to 3.5%. So just last week, they hiked 50 basis points, and we have another 100 basis points in of hikes through this year. And we expect that they're going to keep this rate at 3.5. And we can debate about, well, is that high or low, but relative to the history of the euro area, and certainly relative to the history of the last 10 or 15 years, this is tight monetary policy. And the reality here is, given the fact that the economy is looking stronger, the challenges for disinflation that the ECB faces are greater and more pronounced than would otherwise be the case. Bottom line, our growth outlook is we expect slightly positive growth this year. That's up a full percentage point relative to the end of last year. But we expect growth to only accelerate next year to 0.9%, which is hardly a gangbusters performance. And so we remain pretty cautious, even though there's been good news, we remain pretty cautious about the outlook for the euro area over the medium term. Specifically, we're worried about the fight against inflation. The energy transition is likely to be a longer-term challenge. Financial fragilities in the peripheral economies, countries like Italy in particular. And I personally think that there's scope to debate kind of the medium to long run structural competitiveness of Germany. And those are questions we can go into in a few minutes if you want to talk more about that. But in any event, a mild further acceleration in 2024. Let's go to the next slide. Let's talk about the United States. So in the US, I think that this rebalancing from goods to services is particularly front and center. When I think about what is the, and it's true globally, but it's particularly true in the United States, what is the key driver of growth? Services spending. What is the key driver of inflation? Services inflation. What's the key factor driving wage growth in the tight labor market? Well, we just had an absolutely enormous payrolls report on Friday. Sure, some of you saw that, 517,000, right? Of that 517,000 total job creation during the month of January, 128,000 was in leisure and hospitality alone. And educational and health services were another 105,000. So these big services sector employers are generating a lot of jobs. And that really is the source of demand and also a source of wage pressure. So when I think about the key aspects of where the US economy is now, it's really about what's going on with the services sector. Now, given all of that, and I say here, recent data highlight tight labor market, and I actually wrote that before I saw 517,000 on Friday. So if I had written it after Friday's report, I probably would have put an exclamation point on that, right? So recent data highlight the tight labor market. And then I said as wage growth peaked, and again, I probably would have dropped the question mark there. The last week, we got a fair amount of data on wages, and it is pretty clear that wage growth in the United States has peaked. And specifically, you know, a year or so ago, we were running at 5.5% to 6% wage growth in the United States. Now we're probably somewhere between 4% and 4.5%. Okay, so you think about 4% to 4.5%. The Fed, in thinking about how fast it wants wages to grow, and this is a little bit complicated, I won't go into all the details, but I think the Fed can probably live with 3% to 3.25%, maybe 3.5% wage growth, And that's the 2% inflation target plus kind of what trend labor productivity. How much more a worker can produce in an hour. You can also pay the worker for that without having to raise the price because, you know, the worker's making more stuff. And so we've gone from a place where if the Fed's looking for 3.25, that we were 2.5 percentage points above that. And whenever, over the last 60 years in the United States, whenever we've had to disinflate wages, reduce the pace of wage growth by over 2 percentage points, it's been associated with the recession. Okay, what's causing what, I'm not saying, but I can tell you if you go back and look at cases where we brought wages down 2 percentage points, it's always been a recession. But now we're kind of at a place where it's looking like it's more like 1% wage growth in excess of what the Fed can live with. And disinflating 1% is a much less threatening proposition. Further, if you kind of take both sides of what I'm saying here, right? I say the recent data say the labor market's pretty strong, demand's pretty strong, but maybe wage growth has peaked. That's starting to sound a little bit like a soft landing, isn't it? Where you have a pretty decent economy, but inflation is coming down. And that's not my baseline, but these recent data have had a little bit of a hint of soft landing. I don't know how much you've followed kind of the debate amongst economists over the last year, but Larry Summers has been out talking about the U.S. is going to crash, it's going to have a recession, the Fed needs to hike more. Even Larry Summers is starting to say, well, maybe there's a little more chance of a soft landing. Jay Powell talked a fair amount about soft landing. So I think there's still work to be done. Our baseline is that we'll require a recession. But these data that I've described are very, very tantalizing. And then this next bullet kind of flows from the wage. And we've also seen some improvement in inflation. Okay, and what's going on there goes back to kind of my discussion. 6 months ago, 12 months ago, we had inflation in the United States coming from three places. All of these were red hot. Goods inflation was super strong. Housing and shelter inflation was super strong. And services inflation was super strong. Well, over the last 6 months, that picture has really changed. What's happened to goods inflation? Anybody know? It's come down sharply. And why? It makes perfect sense. Why I've been telling you now several times about the rebalancing away from goods. Goods demand is a lot softer than it was before. Those price pressures have attenuated. And so goods inflation is coming down meaningfully. Shelter inflation, this is more complicated. Shelter inflation is tied to house prices and rents, which were going up rapidly until at some point last year. Now they're falling off. And there's actually a lag between what we see in the CPI and house prices and rents. And so the shelter is still rising, but it's pretty clear it's going to be coming down. It's a mechanical process. And once house prices and rents start to fall, the shelter component of the CPI is likely to come off. So when you think about what was driving inflation before, goods, that's better. Service, shelter, it's likely to be better soon. What are we left with? We're left with this non-shelter services inflation. And, you know, that's where the remaining inflation pressures are. But even there, you kind of say, well, I'm a little more optimistic about non-shelter services inflation if wage growth is 4% as opposed to it being 5.5%. So we are, and this was kind of the problem that Jay Powell had in his press conference, is are we making progress toward getting inflation out of the economy? Are we making progress toward disinflating? Absolutely. Absolutely. And in that sense, is this situation looking more sustainable and less disrupted than it was 6 to 12 months ago? Yes, yeah. But, and here's the problem for the Fed and Jay Powell, is are they all the way home? Can they, you know, put up the big mission accomplished banner and say we've defeated inflation? Well, no. you know, looking through inflation right now, maybe the underlying pace is, you know, four-ish, maybe a little less than four, somewhere in there. And what's the Fed's? They asked about the ECB's target. What's the Fed's inflation target? Two, right? So inflation is still well above what the Fed is committed to do. And I think the Fed has a challenge. And my instinct and my concern is that some of the easier parts of the disinflation, right, getting the goods off, which is just a substitution back, disciplining the housing market, that some of the easier parts of disinflation have occurred. But, you know, taking some of the momentum out of the services sector, that could be a tougher kind of proposition, which is kind of boils down to, it's got to convince all of us, you know, to stop spending so much on services. You know, families to say, well, okay, you know, we've got on enough vacations, we'll move back to an annual cycle. Maybe we're not going to go out to that restaurant. It starts really cutting into behavior. And how long it will take to slow the services sector, I think, is very much an open issue. Now, given all of this, kind of, you know, how do we see this playing out? There are kind of upside risks, but we think that getting inflation down to 2% ultimately is going to be a slog. The Fed's now going to have to take the policy rate. It's at between 4.75 and 5, that the Fed's going to have to hike two more or three more times into the 5% range and keep it there for a while. The upshot is going to be, given all of the monetary policy tightening that the Fed has done, as the effects of that are felt in the economy, we call that the monetary policy transmission. As that full transmission of monetary policy is felt in the economy, that we will have a recession. We expect it to be relatively mild, but kind of our sense is that that's what's ultimately going to be necessary to get inflation down from kind of this 4% range and wages from 4%. Down to 2. But there's more upside, as I've indicated. There's more of a pathway through without a recession than I would have thought 6 months ago or even 3 months ago. Let me just see how much time we have here. Let me just talk about one more thing here. Let's go to the very last slide. Yeah, just keep rolling. Right there. Yeah, perfect. Okay, so what I've talked to you about so far is a lot of cyclical developments in the global economy, right? So I've been talking to you about growth and inflation, particularly over the coming year, and central banks' responses and so forth. But I think it's also important for us to bear in mind, you know, I don't know about me and Alejandro, but you folks are going to be alive in, you know, 3, 4, 5 years. Right? It behooves us to think about something beyond this very near-term horizon. And so I think one of the big questions we need to think about, and it's actually relevant to the way the economy adjusts today, is what is that medium-term global economy going to look like? Now, in my mind, I think the best template, and this is very controversial, I think if you talk to 10 economists, you get 10 different answers on this. But in my mind, the best template we have for that medium-term global economy, or if you will, the new normal, is to look at what the global economy looked like in the years before the pandemic. And yeah, the pandemic's been a big deal, it's been disruptive, but I think in that decade or so before the pandemic, there were some deep structural factors, underlying trends that were at work in the global economy that I very much expect will continue to be in play over the medium term. And specifically, we saw the effects of aging demographics, slowing demand. We saw high public and private debt levels weighing on demand. One I don't have up there that's a powerful force is we are seeing increasing global, and particularly in the United States, but globally as well, increased inequality within countries. And all of these are important economic developments. As a result, particularly of those things, we had relatively weak aggregate demand in the global economy. And the upshot was low inflation, restrained growth, and low interest rates. And when I think of what the global economy is likely to look like over the next 5 to 10 years, kind of my expectation is the post-pandemic economy is likely to at least rhyme, if not exactly resemble, that pre-pandemic. And so my baseline is relatively low inflation, restrained growth, lowish rates, and kind of lackluster, but not terrible, performance. As I think about the risks, you know, how could I be wrong, right? What are the places where I could be wrong or things that I might be missing? And I think the number one concern I have about it, this template I've described for the medium term is kind of resembling the pre-pandemic. Is inflation really going to go back and be low again? Are we really, really returning to a low inflation world? And I think there are several scenarios that I highlight here in the chart where maybe that won't happen. One is if there's some kind of persistence of the current challenges. You know, maybe inflation expectations just get anchored at a higher level, central banks aren't as credible on the other side or some other factor. And there's just more persistence of this episode of very, very high inflation. Inflation never really gets back down to central bank targets again. Another possibility, and all of these I put in there with question marks because they're not my base case, but they're possible. Another one that you hear a lot about is, well, what about deglobalization? And I think deglobalization is really, really interesting. This kind of the manifestations of globalization really came to the front in the mid-2010s with Trump's election and the Brexit vote. And I think it was a lot of domestic voters in various places saying the gains from globalization have not been shared in ways that we think are equitable. And it was a vote against globalization because it was seen as not really helping them, and also having other features that folks didn't like. I think that these deglobalization forces were then further amplified during the pandemic by supply chain disruptions and difficulties there, that many firms had built globally integrated supply chains thinking that shipping and transport was going to be reliable and cheap and predictable. And everything blew up on them in late 2020 and 2021 and early 2022. And they couldn't get ships. Or the cost of shipping a container. This is an incredible statistic, right? The cost of shipping a container from China to the US West Coast was $1,500 pre-pandemic. In the fall of 2021, anybody know how high that went? From 15,000, anybody know what the number is? It got up to over 20,000, almost $21,000, yeah. You know, so more, almost 15 times more. The good news is that's back down as we've had the recovery in the goods sector, on the one hand, on production, and the goods demand has softened. But this wasn't in people's business models. And as a result of that, supply chains, as well as geopolitical things, supply chains are going to be more diversified than they were before. And how much inefficiency is that reprofiling of supply chains going to enter in, going to allow to enter into production in the global economy? Now, having said all that, I don't expect that globalization is going to be thrown into full-scale reverse. I recognize all the risks, tried to explain them as I kind of saw them. That ultimately, what was driving globalization? Why did we globalize? Any thoughts on that? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And if you really want to put it kind of in a bumper sticker, it helped firms make money, right? It made them more efficient. It gave investors opportunities. It gave people in those countries opportunities, and it arose out of kind of desire for people to do things better and to improve themselves. And those are pretty powerful incentives that are hard to blunt entirely. And I do think that on the other side of the pandemic, we'll see more of a balance. And so it's not going to be a powerful globalization I'm describing, but I don't think it's going to be a big deglobalization either. And for that reason, I don't think it's going to be a big disinflationary force. But I spent a lot of time on it because it's possible, and it's something for us to think about for the inflation reason, but more broadly thinking about what is this, what are some features of this world we're likely to be living in. And then finally, and I won't go into this one at all, but net zero, when I think about the economic implications, apart from the necessity of doing it, thinking about that transition path, what that transition path entails is you got to start pricing carbon. And that basically means something that firms have been using for free, now it's got to be given a meaningful price. And in the economic lexicon, we have a term for that. It's called, it's a supply shock. Moves the aggregate demand curve in. Similarly, in order to do net zero, we're going to need to have a lot of investment. Trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars, staggering amount of investment. And I interpret that as a move of the aggregate demand curve out. So you've got the supply curve moving in, and the demand curve moving out. You know that you're going to have higher inflation. And I do think that the transition through net zero is likely to be inflationary. Can central banks respond? Absolutely. But still, I think that that's the way the wind's blowing. So those are three upside risks to inflation. And of course, the great wild card. What can step in and bail everything out and fix everything from net zero to aging demographics is productivity and innovation. And you know, I'm bullish on that. But we got a lot of work to do if that's going to be, you know, if that's going to be our answer, our salvation on this. So, bottom line, you know, kind of softish, longer term outlook with maybe some upside inflation risks. So, I think that's a good place to stop. Still gives us, you know, 15 or so minutes for Q&A. And thanks so much.
Thanks, Nathan. So. So you are much more optimistic on the short term. I mean, I guess due to the data that has been coming in, and therefore, I mean, thinking about this kind of reversal of the negative supply shocks that we saw in the last 18 months, leading us to a situation in which maybe we go back to where we were pre-pandemic with the help of higher interest rates, but without the need of such a deep recession or even in a good state of the world without the need of a recession in the US, the help of China opening up and maybe flipping the choice that they did in the trade-off between public health and the economy after 2 years and a half of lockdowns, moving towards focusing on the economy and not weighing so much public health, and that helping the world economy go back to a more dynamic place, but still a year in which we will have low growth and high inflation, but maybe a little bit better on both accounts than what we thought at the end of last year. And maybe you're a little bit more agnostic about the medium term with a lot of factors and generating a lot of uncertainty of where the world economy is going to stabilize. So. With that, I mean, we will open it up to questions. Let's take a round of three questions, and please tell us your name and the school you're in.
Hi, my name is Max Gunlock. I'm a sophomore in the SFS. My question is, obviously, thank you for this amazing talk, first of all. With Kuroda leaving the Bank of Japan, obviously, very soon, what do you see as the biggest policy changes in Japan coming up?
Hi, my name is Haley, and I'm a graduate student in SFS. I had a question about the European case, because you mentioned concerns about financial stability in countries such as Italy, even though there's about 100 basis points worth of hikes left to go. I was wondering, do you foresee the ECB using the transmission protection instrument to try and offset some of those risks? Thank you.
Any more questions? Hi, my name is Ann. I'm a freshman in the McDonough School of Business. I have a question about kind of like national security and global trade. I heard rumors that the Netherlands and Japan have thought about pulling out of trade, technology trade with China, specifically AI chips. US has been trying to do that too. How would that affect kind of the technology global supply chain?
Great questions. Let me just say to Alejandro's summing up that it may be that I'm too affected by the recent data. And, you know, they have been good over the last, 6 weeks or 2 months. But I also recognize that the next couple of months might be bad. But I think that's probably one of the occupational hazards I have being a private sector economist. You kind of roll with the data a little bit. These are three really, really good questions. Kuroda's departure will be a absolutely watershed event. He served as governor of the Bank of Japan for two terms. He'll be leaving in April. What it is clear is that his yield curve control, or YCC policy, that's been in place in recent years. He has modified it a little bit, but it's absolutely clear, and this is our expectation for Citi's economics team, is that the new governor, once the new governor is in place, is going to have to back away from that. That YCC policy entails massive asset purchases on an ongoing basis, potentially, and it's just not sustainable. I think that Kuroda has probably shown his successor as maybe his final act of creativity as a central banker, and Kuroda has a lot of them, how to exit YCC, which is something we didn't know before. And I think what you'll see them do is probably in April or May, announced that they're abolishing YCC, but they're also going to significantly increase the amount of asset purchases that they do. And what that will allow them to do is there's no YCC, so the yield can move more, but they'll have enough firepower with the asset purchases to make sure any market moves are orderly and incremental. But that is a big deal. The markets are pricing this in. As a result of that, the yen has rebounded substantially. The yen was up to 150 against the dollar in October. It's now down below 130. On the ECB's TPR, transmission policy instrument, I am cautiously optimistic that in this environment where the macro is a little bit better, that the peripheral economies like Italy and Spain and so forth will be able to skate through without having their spreads blow out and requiring the ECB to actually use this instrument that it's announced. I do believe that if things got bad enough that they would use the TPI. I think that ultimately for Madame Lagarde and her colleagues it is, we will do whatever it takes. But I, for their sake, I hope they don't have to. I strongly think they're deeply desirous that they don't have to go there. And the tone, you know, both in Europe and globally is better than what we had feared. So I think the wind's blowing in the right direction for them. But, you know, they'll do what they have to, and we'll use it if things deteriorate further. On this issue about the U.S. pushing other countries to limit their tech trade with China, indeed, the U.S. has been doing that, exerting pressure on allies. I think it is making progress, and some of these countries are coming along. And what I think, this is another aspect of the deglobalization that I was talking about. Another word for deglobalization is fragmentation. And when I think about possibilities for fragmentation in the global economy, I kind of think for trade and finance, the US and China, you know, we're not thrilled about it, but we kind of know that we've got to live with each other right now. And one observer is called kind of the way things will be in that space is managed strategic competition. And I think that's a reasonable characterization of what you'll see. Tech has been something several notches more severe. Well, I think the US is deeply disturbed by the idea that China might benefit from US technology. And I think the Biden administration is concerned that China may ultimately take some of that technology and use it in a way that is inconsistent with U.S. interests. And that's just my characterization of their views. And I do see kind of a deeper divide, a deeper schism emerging on the tech front between the United States and China, and potentially with the United States bringing in other allies. I think we may move to a world where, you know, technology operates in two spheres. I don't know what that means for the global economy. It's got to be a negative, but it does kind of feel like that's the place where the divide is the most gaping, and where there's the least elasticity, I would say, on the U.S. side. And I think it is a big risk that we move into kind of a world of fragmented technology.
Hello, thank you so much for the talk. I'm Nina, I'm doing data science for public policy. My question is, I think for today, we have been talking mostly about the big economies, but like we haven't really touched on like the emerging markets and obviously the developing countries. And as you mentioned, as globalization will be happening, I wonder how the relationship's going to look like, whether the inequality will be getting wider, and I think there has been more discussion of how the economy should shape in a different way for developing countries in a more sustainable way, and there has been debate about like how, who's going to fund it, how it's going to be. I wonder whether with the capital flow going into those changes will also going to, if you're expecting it to be, have some kind of changes in the future. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Charlie, and I am from the Graduate School of Continuing Study. And my question is, how do you think the recovery of China's economy after the pandemic, in light of the recession you mentioned in EU and US? So the driver of the exporting business is kind of shrinked in the future, I think. So what's your point for the future of China's recovery? Thank you.
Hey, I'm TJ. I'm a second year law and policy student. I'm interested in the effect that you believe climate change will have on these economic projections. You mentioned net zero, but I did notice that just some of the broader effects that are being projected related to climate change were sort of absent from the conversation. Is there a reason for that? How are you thinking about the way that labor, you know, supply chains and other major economic, you know, factors might be affected by those changes?
Yeah, all really, really good questions. And you are, the observation that I focused on big economies, the United States, the euro, and China is absolutely right. I think, again, you're seeing certain accents that I have as a result of where I work and who I talk to, but you know, the emerging markets are absolutely critical from an economic and market standpoint, and also from a geopolitical standpoint. Kind of my feeling is that you think about Latin America versus you think about Asia versus you think about Central and Eastern Europe. The various forces and factors and stories that are at work in each one are quite different. Of those three, I'm probably the most pessimistic about Central and Eastern Europe, in that that region right now, for obvious geopolitical reasons, is disrupted and it's challenging. For Latin America, as you saw, we had some recessions in our outlook. We had a recession for Brazil in the first half and Mexico in the second, essentially echoing the United States. But through 2022, these Latin American economies were much more resilient than what we were expecting. And specifically for Brazil, we were expecting Brazil to have a recession all of 2022 that never arrived. And now we've got it in the first half of 2023. But Latin America, especially under the circumstances of soft global environment, lots of gyrations in commodity prices, and importantly, significant tightening from the Federal Reserve, has been performed better than we would have expected. And I think the key question, even if there are recessions, we don't think they're going to be extremely deep. And I think a key question for 2023, which is for Latin America, but it's also for financial markets, is when does risk aversion in the markets change? When does it shift from being negative to being more positive? And I think at that point, you can see Latin American currencies start to appreciate and those capital inflows return. I can tell you, having spoken to some traders, that, you know, folks trading emerging market debt and global debt and assets look at the high policy rates in some of these Latin American economies and are kind of licking, you know, just waiting, chomping at the bit, so to speak, for risk aversion and global environment to be a little more constructive. And when there is, that so-called carry that you can earn in these countries could be pretty attractive. Even though I know that Alejandro has a more informed view on Latin America than I do. Do you want to comment, actually?
No, sorry. I mean, I agree with you. I mean, I think there are a lot of domestic problems in Latin America that might delay or subtract into some of the optimism that you're expressing. I mean, from the medium-term perspective, you tend to think, I mean, relatively high commodity prices, a region of the world that is relatively well-placed on alternative energies, and a relatively young population vis-a-vis advanced economies. I mean, a lot of the factors that you mentioned here should be positive factors for Latin America. On the other hand, I think the domestic political economy situation makes it extremely complex to forecast policies that will allow these countries to really reap the benefits of this external situation, especially if interest rates in the medium term, as you were saying, might go back to relatively low levels, because you're thinking that the world economy, once it controls the inflation blip, eventually will go back to a situation of excess savings. And that will also should be positive for Latin America if they're able to weather this transition of high interest rates.
Yeah, nicely said. And then for emerging Asia, I would say positive dividend from the rebound in the Chinese economy, but that then gets into the second question. And we do see the Chinese economy accelerating from roughly 3% growth in 2022 to 5.7% growth in 2023. But we think that that rebound is going to be led by the consumer spending, and specifically consumer spending in services. And so the upshot is, yes, there's going to be some positive spillover to emerging Asia, to Europe, to other parts of the world, but it is not going to be as pronounced as been the case in the past with previous Chinese recoveries that were more about investment and infrastructure and goods expenditure. When you're thinking about services spending, that's more domestically produced stuff and is going to have more of an effect on the domestic economy as opposed to stuff that China might import. So positive spillovers to emerging Asia and Germany and Europe, but not as great as in the past. Maybe also in emerging Asia, still a little bit of a tailwind from reopening on the other side of COVID. I think that's likely to be a plus for the region this year. And the big minus is, you know, we've said this is not a great global outlook. We think the global economy grows below trend by a percentage point or so. Excluding China and its acceleration, we see global growth a little bit over 1%. So it's an unspectacular kind of global outlook. And those emerging Asian economies are exporters. So those are a few thoughts and kind of a regional level in response to your question. Inequalities across countries, I think we can say that in recent years, the emerging markets have grown faster than the advanced economies or developed market economies. For a long time, we had a two-tier global economy with EM growing much quicker. I think that's sustainable, but still, that kind of process of convergence is long and slow and challenging and difficult. And there are a lot of countries with a lot of potential that we kind of expected through the course of my career, a country like Brazil was gonna make meaningful progress. And, you know, it's got a lot of rich endowment and capable people, but it's still got a long way to go. India is, you know, behind Brazil in the development process. You know, there's there are big gaps. And then regarding climate change, yeah, I emphasized more kind of the deltas of us doing something. The deltas of us not doing something are huge uncertainty, disruptions, problems with capital stock, you know, really a lot of, you know, 90 and uncertainty, I would almost say, right? And 90 and uncertainty is the unknown unknowns. The things would be really bad if we don't do something. And that's the important point here, that as I say, look, you know, it's going to be expensive to get to net zero, and we're going to have to price carbon, and we're going to have some inflation pressures along the way. That's not an argument not to do it, but it is an argument that as we're doing it, it's important for us to have our eyes wide open and be aware of what the macroeconomic implications are. And is it going to be are there going to be some challenges along that path? Yeah. But it's still definitely worth it, so we don't have to deal with this outbreak of uncertainty, which frankly, I would have a hard time. If you told me that we weren't gonna address climate change and that I had to incorporate that into my macro forecast, I'm not sure how I would do it. You know, I don't know if it's labor, it's capital, you know, it's all of the above. I don't know how big it is, but it would definitely be very negative.
Perfect. Hi, my name is Eating. I'm a graduate first year student, and so thank you for today's talk. And I'm curious, what's your views on the United Arab Emirates economies? Because I noticed that the United Arab Emirates has like their economies keep growing during these 3 years, even it is in the pandemic. Yeah, so I.
Hi, my name is Leila. I'm double majoring in politics and economics, and thank you so much for your presentation. And I was wondering, discussing deglobalization and growth and imbalances in international trade, do you think we're moving towards a period where the Chinese renminbi is going to somewhat have more influence on smaller scale economies to the point where, the dollar smiley theory will actually, you know, stop being of such validity, and maybe the U.S. dollar could default on its own currency?
Ooh, I missed that last part. Say that again.
If the U.S. like could default on its own currency.
For the record, no to the last part. But on the UAE, How many of you have been to Dubai? Yeah, Dubai is a really interesting place, isn't it? So to a first order, I think the UAE economy is highly geared toward energy prices. And if you say why they've done relatively well, I think it's that, you know, oil prices collapse and then they bounce back. And especially over the last year, year and a half, oil prices have been pretty high. But there has been, by policymakers there, an effort to diversify some of that oil wealth, and specifically investing in the development of a major regional urban center. And Dubai is an extraordinary place. And could it become, over time, I think it probably is, but even more so over time, a key, you know, center globally? I'd say absolutely. But, you know, right now, I think it's primarily about oil. Another way to put it is, you know, if oil prices in the green world, where we've shifted to renewable energy and we're less reliant or not reliant on carbon, the economic outlook for the UAE, I think, would be meaningfully more challenging than it is today. Even though of the various oil producers, I think they stand out as one that's done a particularly good job of trying to diversify the wealth from oil. On deglobalization and the Chinese renminbi. So, you know, China's economy is growing. It's becoming more powerful. A bigger part of the global economy. China itself is more influential. On the margin, is that helpful in terms of the prominence of the Chinese renminbi, the CNY? Absolutely. But I see it really as being incremental. And I don't see in the next, let me even stick my neck out, 10 to 20 years, I think I can even go out 20 years. I don't think that the renminbi is going to be a major challenge to the dollar. And I think that what you're seeing with the dollar is people like to transact in and hold currencies that they are familiar with. And they know the dollar, they know U.S. institutions, they know U.S. laws, U.S. courts, they know U.S. markets and how things work here. And kind of the sum and substance of that is, even though our political system is very noisy and disrupted, at the end of the day, when the stress is on, people come home to dollars. And it is the safety of familiarity. In contrast, during times of challenge, we've seen it even within the last decade, when Beijing has faced stresses, controls come on. And if you want to have a reserve currency, you got to be confident. People have to be confident they can get in and that they can get out. And, you know, China's making progress, and maybe in some years' time, but I think it's probably more decades than years, things will go better. In terms of dollar default, the U.S. has substantial resources. This is an enormous economy. This is an economy and a country where we can pay our bills. Now, we have this debt ceiling standoff, and could we get to in a place where politically, going back to what I was saying about the politics, where there's a brief period where we're not current on our debt? It's a possibility. I think it's a relatively low one. That even if we go across the debt ceiling, my sense is there are things that can be done there. But that, it's a small possibility, but it should be zero, and it's not. So I definitely am not expecting any kind of default on dollar assets, but, you know, where our politics make things a little more uncertain maybe than they need to be.
Well, with that, I think not only with your presentation, but, I mean, with the answers to these very broad set of questions. Going all
Good
over
questions.
The globe, I think we covered, and we basically, you deliver on the title of this presentation, that is the World Economic Outlook, and not only in the short term, but also going forward into two decades. I mean, you made some predictions of the status of the dollar going out 20 years, and then you venture a little bit into the transition to non-oil-based economies in the Middle East. So I think we got a great overview of the current situation in the world economy and the challenges in the medium term. So with that, I mean, let me thank Nathan for being with us today. Thanks, David, from the Psaros Center. And obviously all the staff that contributed to put together this event. And thank you for coming.